Welcome to Ask a Librarian. My name is Carolyn Regal, and I'm a librarian here at the Madison Public Library and also the assistant branch manager. And
I'm deaf. And I'm just living my best deaf.
I'm just kidding. I'm Gant Moore. I'm a clerk here at the Madison branch of the public library in Huntsville, and today we're going to talk to you about a spooky subject for this spooky time, one of my favorite times of year. We're going to talk to you about a few haunted libraries throughout these great United States. And we're very excited to talk about this for you.
Yeah. We get lots of questions about spooky things and hauntings this time of year. So take it away, Gant.
All right. Well, the first place I'm going to tell you about is the Old Bernardsville Library in Bernardsville, New Jersey. It's called the Old Bernardsville Library. They've since built a new building, and this one is no longer in use, though it is still standing. And this is an interesting place. The building was built all the way back in 1710, and the story of the haunting starts around the time of the Revolutionary War. So the library was in the same building as a place called the Vealtown Tavern, which was like a little inn and tavern. A lot of soldiers were there around that time.
Right.
And the person haunting the place was the innkeeper's daughter, a woman by the name of Phyllis Parker.
Ooh.
And she met and fell in love with this doctor who was a guest there at the time. And, you know, they started a little love affair. But, dabba-dee, dabba-die, the man is a British spy.
Wow.
So,
okay.
And apparently he was not very good at it because he was caught and got what I like to call a necktie for keeps. And that was that until, for some reason, they decided to send the body back to the tavern in a coffin.
Ooh.
And the first person to discover it, of course, was Miss Phyllis Parker. And she snapped.
Scarred for life.
Yeah, she, oh, just destroyed. Like, Europe circa 1349. It was just terrible. And she just has a complete mental breakdown, never recovers. And all the way, like, up until the building was replaced in around, like, the mid-90s, I think, people reported seeing her just walking around the building, you know, getting cold chills and, you know, feeling a presence. And a lot of people reported just hearing her sobbing uncontrollably.
Ooh.
Understandable and very tragic. But, you know, for what it's worth, if I remember correctly, her ghost was given a library card.
Oh, that's a first. Has she checked anything out?
No.
No,
she is not.
Books.
No, there's nothing that's going to help her at this point.
I think that's the first one we heard about getting a library card. All right, that's awesome. The first one that I found out some information on is the Percival Library in Loudoun County, Virginia. And the Percival Library is about an hour west of D.C. And I have a personal connection there because I actually worked there when I had my first professional librarian job. And the staff all talked about Gertrude Roby, which is this lady here. She's a very formidable looking person.
She looks like she built the library with money she got from moving moonshine during Prohibition.
Well, I don't think so, because she was a very conservative person.
Oh.
And she ruled the library with an iron fist for over 40 years. But anyhow, basically, she's dubbed as the librarian who will not leave. And she was very stern about what could be on the shelves. She pretty much told everybody what they could read for about 40 years. Nothing, no romance, nothing with any hint of eroticism. And after she died, books would start to fly off the shelves. That's where the paranormal tie came.
What, you mean like they got a lot of business? Or?
Well, you mean, did that give them a lot of business?
Never mind.
Anyhow, she censored what could be on the shelves. She had her own list of banned books, including Uncle Tom's Cabin, and she stuffed all these books in a fireplace. And during renovations, some workmen found these books, and their fingertips were actually burned when they picked them up. So she also caused doors to lock and unlock, footsteps on empty floors after the hours of the building, and all sorts of other paranormal phenomena. But anyhow, she's still running the library all these years later. And she's well known in the town of Percival. So what else did you find out?
She knows her place.
She knows her place.
Yeah. Well, It wasn't hard to find, but the Peoria Public Library is one of the more well-known haunted libraries in the country. Now, this is a picture of the old building from...
That's impressive.
Yeah, it's from around the beginning of the 20th century. What's interesting is they've since gotten a new building that is in around the same place, but it is still haunted by the same things. Now... Buckle up for this story. I love the story of this library. So it begins before the library was even there. So in 1830, there's this woman named Mrs. Andrew Gray. And her brother dies, and she gets custody of her nephew. But unfortunately for her, the nephew is kind of a ne'er-do-well, kind of a screw-up. He won't get a job, and he's always getting in trouble with the law. So she hires this lawyer whose name, I swear to God, is David Davis. And to try and keep him out of trouble, and he does more or less. But you know, like all those jokes about those cliche jokes about how lawyers are scumbags and stuff.
Right.
This guy is all those jokes rolled up into a burrito. So he keeps the nephew out of trouble, but he pushes the family further and further into debt until he manages to convince them to put up their house as collateral. And not long after that, the nephew's body is found floating down a river. And she, Miss Gray, just decides to put a curse on her house, which I did not know you could do. I thought you had to be certified for that
definitely.
Or something.
Oh, you can do it.
But yeah, you can apparently do that. So nobody seems to think so.
Okay.
But so fast forward to like 1894, that's when the library is built. The first three directors of the library all die under intense circumstances. The first director, Mr. E.S. Wilcox, is struck by a streetcar right in front of the library in 1915. The second director, Mr. Samuel Patterson Prowse, suffers a fatal heart attack during a board meeting in 1921.
Wow.
And the third director, Dr. Edwin Wiley, commits suicide by drinking arsenic in 1924.
That's not a nice way to go.
Well, yeah, admittedly, that probably didn't have much to do with the library. Take care of your mental health out there, everyone.
Right.
But that was all within 10 years. And, you know, and in addition to the weird happenings, people kind of report a lot of similar things. The books fly off the shelves, entire shelves fall over unprovoked.
Uh-huh.
But the first director that I mentioned, E.S. Wilcox, he apparently is still seen quite often. That seems to be a theme. Librarians can't seem to let go of their work. He was uh-huh. very fond of the place and is still seen in the shelves, like making sure everything's in order and
right.
looking for books. So, I mean, at least he seems to be a friendly presence.
A friendly one. So he never really retired.
Yeah, that's a good way of looking at it.
Okay. Another library that's really interesting is the Willard Library. And the Willard Library is in Evansville, Indiana, and was founded in 1885 by Mr. Willard. He was a wealthy businessman in town, and he built this beautiful Victorian Gothic building.
Very nice
that
building.
You can see here. It is very,
very
nice.
Building.
Anyhow, they've really turned their haunting into a thing, and every October they have ghost tours. They have an actual ghost camp, and we'll put the link on our website that you can click on to see some of the eerie things that go on. And also some of the different paranormal TV shows have filmed there. In 2007, some local mediums actually confirmed that there was a ghostly presence. And the ghostly presence is allegedly Louise Carpenter. And Louise Carpenter was the daughter of this Mr. Willard. And some say that she's haunting the library because he left most of his money to the library. And others say that she's just a friendly presence. And she was first seen in the 1930s by a custodian. He saw an apparition of a Victorian lady. And strange things started happening. People would smell a lilac perfume when she was around.
Oh, lovely.
Faucets would turn off and on. Elevators would go up and down.
Why is it that ghosts always seem to like want to increase the utility bill?
They want to mess with the utility bills. Yeah, I have absolutely no idea. Anyhow, I think one of the weirdest things that happened was during a renovation, she followed one of the youth services librarians, Margaret, home. And stayed with her during the entire renovation.
Stalking is not cool in this life or the next.
Stalking is not cool. So that was sort of one of the strangest things. And she's dubbed the Gray Lady. And
the Gray
you
Lady.
Can definitely check her out on their ghost cam. So Did you have another one?
No, I think we're done here.
You think we're done here?
Well, there are more.
Plenty more.
And you can find out about them in some of the books we have listed in front of us. Carolyn, I believe you used this one here in the middle for your research, right?
Yes, yes. This one by Jacqueline Proctor Gray, When Spirits Walk. She's a local author. She does normally do a haunted tour in Huntsville. I don't know if she's doing one this year or not. But she's been all over town, and there's some very interesting stories in there, including the Black Widow of Hazel Green. So I encourage you guys to check this one out and read for yourselves. And thank you for joining us.
Yes, thank you. Remember to smash that like button and subscribe. Hit that bell to stay updated with notifications. And thank you for joining us here today.